Buddy.
Morning.
This is on. Is the audio working? I don't know. Monica, who's the... How do we... I don't know.
We're going to have to speak loudly, I guess.
Oh, you do? Okay. Good. Okay. Great.
State of the art.
Good morning. I'd like to call today's Sports Authority Board of Directors meeting for the October 21st, 2015 meeting to order. Thank you, everyone, for attendance today. This is, I think, the entire board, which is exciting that we could all be here today. And I know there's a lot of excitement about being at the Nashville Sounds ballpark for the first time, First Tennessee Ballpark. Thank you to the Sounds for hosting us. There's a lot of excitement outside, and it's a really good energy, so we're excited to be here. And as usual, the appeals process for any action of this body can be found at the top of today's agenda. In your board packet, you should have a copy of the September 16th meeting minutes. Those were provided last week. Are there any questions or additions to the minutes?
You know, I was wondering, could we add to the minutes that chart that we had about our... You know, that was prepared for us about the bond and the, you know, where the revenues go.
The finance
like
summary
that.
Overview?
Right, as an exhibit.
The debt.
Yeah.
Indebtedness.
Right. I just think it would be helpful to have that.
Okay.
Because there was a discussion about that.
And I think that's a good point. So we have a motion to approve the minutes.
I move to approve with the addition of the exhibit.
Second.
Motion and second. All in favor with the revision?
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries. As you all know, the Sports Authority is in the midst of a search for its next executive director. The Authority's search committee is being chaired by our Secretary, Kathy Bender. David Wicker and Emmett Wynn have also agreed to sit on this committee. I want to thank each of them for their willingness to serve in this capacity. And at this time, our Secretary, Kathy Bender, will give us an update on where they are in the process.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning. The position of Executive Director of the Nashville Sports Authority Board was posted on September 28th through midnight on October 4th. A total of 90 applicants were received. So we were very pleased with the interest in the position, had some very exciting applicants. Metro Human Resources, thank you, especially Jane Madden, reviewed these applicants very closely, eventually reducing them down to 10 applicants, which we called our preferred candidates. Those candidates have all received telephone interviews, which we just completed yesterday. We've had a couple of marathon days to do that. And from there, the next steps will be that we will invite a number of those from that pool to come in and do an in-person, face-to-face interview. As a courtesy, we would like to notify those candidates first before making that announcement publicly. Once we've done that, there will be a public notice of the meeting for those interviews. The committee will conduct that interview. The Sports Authority Board in its entirety will be invited to participate. And as I said before, it will be free to the public, open to the public. So once we are there, the next steps will be that we will make a recommendation from the committee to the full board for the next executive director of the Nashville Sports Authority. And that will require full approval by the Sports Authority Board. And we're moving quickly with this process, so hopefully we will be naming a new director by the next meeting. So, any questions? Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Kathy. And thank you, Jane Madden and Metro HR. I know they've worked really, really diligently on this process, and we appreciate all of your help. Monica Faulkneson will now give us our executive director's report.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Doug Scopel and the Sounds for hosting us here this morning. I know we all are really excited to be here. You go through the construction and through the whole process, and then you get to sit in here and go to the games, and that's very exciting. So thank you. Thank you for that. And I would remind the board that there will be a tour following. If you're able to stay, we'd love for you to do that. And we also would like to take a walk out and see Coach Temple's statue. Hopefully most of you have had a chance to see that, but I understand some of you may not have. So we'll do that as well as part of the tour.
We should get a picture.
We need to get a new picture. We did. We had a picture taken at the dedication or the unveiling, but we'll try to get another one this morning. And then briefly, just to go over the agenda, you've already approved the minutes, and we will make the correction as noted and received Kathy's report on the director search. And then following my report, then Doug Scopel will start us off with the First Tennessee Park report. And in addition to the Sounds monthly report that you receive, in this month's packet, then you received the Sounds 2015 Community Report. It's an annual report, and it's lengthy. It's about 50 pages, so we did not make a copy for everyone. You've received it electronically, but we also have a few copies on the table, and I'm sure that we'll be hearing more about that. And then following the Sounds report, we'll move into the Nissan Stadium report, which Janine Kaufman and Bob Flynn will give. And there is an article in the paper, maybe some of you have seen it, on Janine, and it's a great article, and there's a copy in your packet as well, right behind the Titans report, if you want to get a chance to look at that. Following the Nissan Stadium report, we'll move into just a brief update on the stadium refurbishment project. I know there have been some questions and some interest on that. And then after that, Sean Henry will give his report on the 2015 IEBA Venue of the Year, Bridgestone Arena and Ford Eye Center. And then we'll conclude with a report from the Nashville Sports Council President and CEO, Scott Ramsey, who was here this morning, and he'll give us an update on the NSC and also the Music City Bowl and the 2016 All-Star Game weekend, which we're really excited about. Good morning. Thank you. So what I'd like to do right now is just back up a little bit and let's talk about the committee structure. A couple months ago, I know there was some communication and we've let you all know that we are going to move back into committees in that structure, and I think that's very important. And in your packet behind tab 2, you'll find a copy of the Sports Authority's governance and best practices policy. This document is behind my report. And it states that the Sports Authority will have two standing committees, the Finance and Audit Review Committee, and the Personnel or an Executive Committee. And then ad hoc committees can also be formed if needed. You've already heard from Kathy, who's chairing the ad hoc committee, and as our chairman said, then serving with her on the committee are David Wicker and Emmett Wynn. And then the Personnel or the Executive Committee, as we also call it, is comprised of officers of the board and then another standing board member. So this committee will be led by our chair, and then Vice Chair Margaret Bim will be serving on that, as well as Kathy Bender, our secretary, and Coach Temple. Okay. And then our final committee is the Finance and Audit Review Committee, and it will be chaired by our Vice Chair Margaret. And then the other Finance Committee members are Dudley West and Ralph Perry. The Finance and Audit Review Committee has already scheduled its first meeting, and that will be on Wednesday, November 4th at 8:30 a.m. And we hope that that you will be able to come. Even if you're not serving on the committee, we would love for you to participate and to come and to listen and just get, a different level of understanding and more details on the audits and on other financial reports as they come in. So we'd like to thank the authority and those of you who have agreed to serve on the committees or who have expressed interest, and we really appreciate your time and your commitment. I want to thank Margaret Darby too, because she helped get all of this together, so we appreciate that. And then finally, and this was mentioned in an earlier piece of communication to the board, but last week, Mayor Megan Berry announced her appointment of Talia Lomax O'Neill as Metro's next finance director. Talia was appointed as acting director of finance last month, and she previously served as the deputy finance director. And I, probably most of you know her or have met her before, and she is very capable and will do a fantastic job. She's been with Metro Finance for 15 years, and her primary responsibility has been the preparation and monitoring of Metro's capital and operating budgets. And so last night she was confirmed by the Metro Council, and we look forward to working with her as we move forward. If there are no questions, this concludes my report.
Any questions? Thank you, Monica, for providing the board materials in advance of this meeting. I think that's been very helpful, and we appreciate you getting materials out. I know everyone's time is valuable, and it's nice to have an opportunity to review things. Next up is the First Tennessee Park Report, and since you guys are hosting us, your first at bat, no pun intended. Doug Scoble, Senior Vice President with the Nashville Sounds.
It's a pleasure to have you guys here. I think most of you have already seen the ballpark, but if you haven't, this is another way that we can have good events in here year-round. So pleased to have you, and look forward to showing a few of you around, or all of you around afterwards for the tour and go see the statue and all that. Since our last meeting, obviously our season is over with, but what's really starting to happen related to the ballpark is a lot of recognition through awards, through not so much baseball, but through construction. There's been the Nashville Downtown Partnership honored this ballpark for one of its play awards, just for a fun place in the city for people to come and have fun. They only recognize a handful of those every year, and then they picked us this year. A lot of the construction firms and engineering firms and all the sub-trades that worked out here that put a lot of time and sweat and effort into this place are starting to submit their portions of what they did here at First Tennessee Park to their respective trade associations for the annual year-end awards. There's a construction, ABC Construction banquet tonight where this ballpark will be recognized. So I don't have all the specifics on all those, but the exciting part is it's not just the baseball and sports and fan experience stuff. It's people that put their time and planning years in advance of this place to make it what it is are starting to get recognized. So we're starting to try to compile a list of those, and we'll pass those along to you as those come down the pipe as people are recognized. From the sound side, our 2016 schedule is out. We're currently in the process of renewing season tickets, sponsorships. Obviously, that's been a good process for us so far after a great first season here. We're encouraged. We're early in the process right now, but opening day is April 7th, so however many months away. We're making good progress on that. And just a reminder, baseball winter meetings are coming to Nashville in December. The Sounds don't have a real big part of that. We'll be hosting a few events here at the ballpark with our league office and some of the construction vendors that actually worked on this that want to showcase their work. But that's just another way to get Nashville in the spotlight. And so that we're excited to be part of that. As was mentioned earlier, the community relations report was sent out to you guys. It's rather lengthy. I'm not going to go through it. There's no point in going through the PowerPoint. But just, it was asked by Kim, I think, in earlier meetings to kind of better document what all we're doing in the community. So that's a small sample. This is the first year of this ballpark. The Sounds are at a higher profile than we've been in a long, long time in this city. So that's just the first step, and we're going to continue to grow a lot of those programs. This year was such a whirlwind. We got in here pretty much a couple weeks before opening day. So just getting the ballpark up and running was our focus. Now we can really reach out, do a lot more fun things in the community. But hopefully you could see what we are starting to kind of set up and grow from in the community. If you have any questions on those things, I'm happy to take them whenever. One community event we're going to do next week is called our Sweets and Treats event. We're going to reach out to nonprofits, organizations in the area. I think we've got 9 different ones that are bringing underprivileged kids here who may not have a chance to go trick-or-treating. We're going to have all our sweet holders and the Sounds and a few of our other sponsors set up the sweets. And this level where we're at right now is kind of a Halloween-themed area. for the kids to come through and get a chance to experience that. A lot of them are going to be from our local neighborhood, but they're bringing them in from a few different areas. So that's something that, you know, again, just our stature in this area, way we can connect with the community, felt like it was a good program for us to do. We hope that's something we can do for a lot of years. We hosted on October 3rd a beer festival here at the ballpark. As you guys have seen, we've had an awesome fall of weather, except for the two or three days around that beer festival. That day, it was like 56 degrees. It rained, so we didn't have the attendance we would have liked, because those kind of things are very much a, you wait and see what the weather's going to do. If the forecast looks bad, you don't show up. But we had 2,000 people here. We had it was a good first event like that for us to host here, that's a non-sounds game. We look forward to doing more of those things in the future. So that was the people that were here did have a good time despite the weather, and we just hope to keep doing those in the future. We've got a few events coming up here. The National League of Cities is being hosted in Nashville. We've got a couple events tied into that that people are wanting to show off the ballpark as part of, you know, all the great things in Nashville. It's one of the many venues and whatnot we could talk about, but they want to have us be a part of that. The other thing we announced since the last meeting was we're going to host a week before our season next year on March 29th. We're going to host Vanderbilt baseball against Belmont, so an in-town rivalry game. So that's exciting. We look forward to doing a little more with the colleges and high schools, but that'll be the first non-sounds event we have here that's a baseball game. So that should be a fun event. We'll be releasing more information on that in the near future. But pretty brief report. Like I said, we're just in the planning mode for next year, trying to start thinking about promotions we can do out here and just ways to make this place better in year two. And as somebody alluded to earlier, you can see being here a lot of the construction that continues to go on around us, so we're excited about that.
Any questions of Doug? Thank you, Doug.
Thanks.
Oh, I'm sorry, Emmett.
Not particularly a question, Doug, but just a statement. On last Sunday, I was listening to one of the top radio sessions that were going on, and there still seems to be probably too much negative feeling in this, some parts of this community right here, about the sounds, about how we accelerated the building of the stadium. Maybe they wanted more input. I don't know, but whatever you can do to do community relations, I think will pay back down the road. And I think that is a good step that you've already started. And just if there's anything we can do to get the community a little bit more on board.
Absolutely. Yeah, part of this time of year for us is taking a step back, looking at what we did well, what we might not have done well, and try to improve across the board. And that's a great example of a way we can do that. So, yes, we will do that.
Okay.
Thanks. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yes,
next up, we have the Nissan Stadium report, which will be given jointly by Titans representatives, looks like Bob Flynn, Vice President of Facilities and Game Day Operations is first, and then Janine Kaufman, CFO, will be next.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Doug, thanks for hosting us here today. See if I can figure this thing out. Is this right? Yep. So we've been busy over since the last meeting. We've had four games, three regular season NFL games, and a TSU game. This last weekend we had both the TSU homecoming on Saturday, and then we had the Titans game on Sunday versus the Dolphins. And then on the 27th and on the 11th, we hosted the Bills and the Colts. So we've been busy there. So that's four games in last month, I guess. And we've got another one coming up this week. And so we'll be busy again this weekend. But the building so far, we haven't had any major issues. Things have run fairly well, and we've been pretty happy with it. I mean, on the field, we want better results on the field, but we think we found a quarterback. Marcus Mariota was the NFL rookie of the month. Is that right? For September. So we feel real good there, but, you know, we want we're still, just like everybody in the whole building, wants some better results on the field, but, you know, we know they're still working at it, and it's a process, but we think we found the right guy there. So any questions about games so far? Any attended any with any questions or anything. I've, you know, whenever after every games, Mondays and Tuesdays, I get calls from fans or emails. I reach out to every one of them, and I talk to each of them, and I tell them I'm gonna look into if they've got an issue. I'm gonna try to see what it is, and I was telling Dudley, I was telling Ralph, I had a call about a speaker issue in section 203, row E, 1 and 2, and I got an email on Monday. Said thank you, you listened, so he was very pleased. So I can't say every time it's always like that, but I do. I call every single person that I get an email from or a call from, and I hear them, and I just tell them I'm gonna work on it. We're trying to get better, and I think we are getting better.
And from a social media perspective too, you guys are monitoring the fan experience.
Yep, we have a gentleman comes in every he actually looks on Saturday and Sundays, and we respond. We had a seat issue last game. Went online and said, hey, my seat's falling forward. We reached out to him, said somebody's on the way. We went there to fix it, and he even responded, thank you for responding so quickly. So that is working as well. So we monitor ours, Aramark's, the Tennessee Titans, all that stuff. So we are paying attention there to try to react as quickly as we can. So those things are working well for us. So for building enhancements or, you know, what's happening in the building, we've told you about the suites. We've been real pleased with that. That's one of our suites. If you're a suite holder, you could choose from three different packages, and this is just one of the packages. You know, we've gotten really good response from all the suite holders about the furniture and all that stuff, so they're really pleased with that. We're happy with it as well. So our gates, I think last time I mentioned, we've got eight gates with cars on top of them or trucks or whatever, and you can see the numbering is so much bigger. People can see them from all over the place. From before you could not, and at night they're lit up. You know, our partner that's putting this up, is they've been great. They've been on time and everything, so we've been real pleased with that. And also we've got two, you know, gate one and gate six, which are east and west. We're not going to have cars there, but we're going to upgrade the signs there, and also the east and west club. So they're going to match them. We won't have the big numbers, but they'll look uniform. So that would be good. Light raker painting. You know, a lot of y'all have seen it. They're pink right now, but we have started, and yesterday we got the first coat of Nissan red up there, so we're real pleased with it. It's going to be a long process. It's going to be 6 to 8 months to get all eight light rakers painted, but you know, we're pleased. I actually had another fan reach out to me and just said yes with a lot of exclamation points behind it. So you know, people see those things. So you know, we're pleased with that process started. Stadium painting along the sides. This is on the west side, on the ramps. So that's just the primer there, but they're moving along quickly. I think this process of the ramps and just on the outside of the building is a 12 to 14 week process. So you know, it's a big building. It's a lot of paint. You know, it's going to take some time, but people are seeing, you know, the changes, and that's what's got me excited about it, is that people are going to see this stuff. People are going to see that things are changing over there. So we're excited about it because it does look good. I think somebody's asked me about, we've actually get calls about from season ticket holders about what's up with the, you know, planters and all that stuff. We should have plants, the new plants going in first, second week of November. And so like before, it's a safety issue. And also just, it will just make the building look a lot better than bushes that just, you know, we had lots of different looks in those planters. So we're excited about that. One too far there. We've got a storm generator program going on right now, which should be finished in the next couple weeks. And then our expansion joints, which I think Monica might have something in there about where we're going to go with that. But we've had a test in there, and it's working well. So, I mean, there's a lot of things going in the building. We're also, next meeting, I should have pictures of our new video walls. We purchased four new video walls, which are, I think, 12 feet by 10 feet for our clubs. And we might actually have one working this Sunday's game. So we're excited about that because, yes, I get, you know, notes from season ticket holders about that as well. So, which I'm happy always to respond. It's coming. It's coming. So any questions? I want to make this fairly quick for y'all, but love to answer anything. Or, you know, we are busy over there, and we're excited about it.
Yeah.
Good.
Any questions?
Nope, that's it. I think Janine's going to come up now. So thank you.
Thanks, Bob. Janine Kaufman. Our celebrity. I've had a couple of articles.
Good morning, everyone. I hope everybody's been out enjoying this great fall weather. It has been beautiful. It's wrecking havoc on my allergies, but other than that, I have absolutely loved it. So I'm going to be pretty brief today. Just wanted to give you a few highlights of what we've been doing on the community side, in particular this month. First of all, it is our Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and we've done a lot. Our theme this year is a crucial catch, annual screening saves lives. And we've really been kicking off the campaign trying to, again, remind women about the importance of getting that annual screening, about doing self-exams, and the importance of kind of taking your health into your own hands, so to say. And so we've really been kicking it off with that. On October the 11th, we actually hosted a lot of our breast cancer survivors at the game. We celebrated their survival stories at halftime. We also gave out pink ribbons to everyone in attendance, and also your pink shades, which I gave everyone. My theme is gotta wear shades. So the other thing we're doing with breast cancer awareness this year is we're rolling that out to some local high schools, a few select high schools. We have some of our players and some of our cheerleaders who are wearing that cool kind of NFL pink gear, and they're going to some of the high schools, and there again, just to remind people about breast cancer awareness so that those kids will go home and say, hey, Mom, did you have a mammogram? Hey, Mom, are you taking care of your health? Mm-hmm. And so it's just another new element that we've added this year. This month is also Domestic Violence Month. We've been doing a lot with domestic violence, and as you can see here, we were named the Community Partner of the Year at the Pearls and Pinstripe Gala, which was held at Nissan Stadium earlier this month. We hosted at this past game 75 domestic violence survivors, and those tickets were actually provided by our players to the domestic violence women. We had them line the tunnel as the players ran out onto the field, and it was just a great day for them. We provided a brunch for them as well, and also there again kind of tried to increase awareness about domestic violence. We ourselves internally actually yesterday had our domestic violence, we call it education at our facility for our players and all of our staff. It's a mandate that is required that they attend the training, and it's again just education about domestic violence and the importance of that, being able to step in if you see something going on. At the game also we gave out $60,000 to our domestic violence partners across Tennessee. Another just great way to give back to our partners in the community and again increase that awareness of domestic violence. This year we also hosted our first annual blood drive at Nissan Stadium. We partnered with St. Thomas Health and the American Cancer Society. We gave blood glucose screenings so people could come in and actually have that test done. They also, we had blood pressure and just some great nutrition information that was given to them about how to eat properly, the importance of exercise, again, promoting that health. And so we really hope to grow that event next year. We continue to honor our military as well with our partners Nissan. We do this at each and every single game where we give back and support the military. And so we're just continuing that importance in the community there. And then, of course, we have our great stadium drives. This here is the pencil box. And last week we did nurses for newborns. And this week I want to remind you we are doing cell phone for soldiers. So if you are coming to the game and you have an old cell phone that you are not using anymore, bring it to the game, put it in one of our donation bins, and we're going to make sure that those get to the soldiers who can really use those overseas. And so that really wraps up our community involvement and what we've been doing there over the last kind of month, kind of at a high level. I mean, there's been a lot of other things going on, but those are some of the high points. And next, I'm going to move into financial information unless there's any questions on community. All right. right, financial. Not a lot has changed on our end in the way of the different funds from last month. But the first off is the user fee, the ticket tax summary. Again, we have two funds. We have the $2 fund and the dollar fund. The $2 ticket tax is $417,000 approximately in that fund, and the dollar ticket tax is $2.5 million. And I'm going to not talk too much about that. I think when we closed on the loan, or you guys closed on the loan on Monday, and I think there's some additional information coming on that next, so I won't talk too much about that. The next two slides are a detail of the $2 fund and the $1 fund, and then this is what has been paid to date in ticket tax. So as you can see, we've paid in about $13 million to date in total into the user fee. Yes.
Thank you, Nancy.
Yep.
So on this slide,
do you want me to go back?
That one. No, it's
this
that one. I just wonder how we're doing for this year, because it looks like we're down a little from two previous years.
We actually, Margaret, have, at the request of Metro, changed the way that our user fee has been remitted. So what we are doing is they wanted more of a steady flow into the user fee fund, and that's something that the banks also kind of requested. And so what we are doing is we are making estimates of the tax for the Titans each and every single month with the true up as the games are played. And so that is why it looks maybe a little bit less, but it's not really less. And so that there again, that was just to even out that cash flow on a monthly basis instead of kind of doing like a roller coaster type of payment.
So it looks like we're on track to do it at least as well as we did last year.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Great. Thanks.
And this is the new report that we added last month. Again, this is the user fees, and these are just the last two games that have been played. Next month, I'll include the 18th from this past Sunday, and then our next game coming up this coming Sunday. As you can see, total tickets distributed, again, that is sold plus the comp tickets, were $65,915 for the 9/27 game and $65,659 for the 10/11 game. And then we back out actual comps, or comps that were allowed under the code, and so you can see those number there, and then that leaves tickets subject to the user fee. So for the 9/27 game, that's $63,597, and for the 10/11 game, that's $63,686. And so, Margaret, this is part of the true up.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So once it's actually, the box office is actually done and it's actually closed out, then we true up what was paid as an estimate for that game.
Thanks. That's very helpful.
Okay. Great. And next, this is our capital fund summary. Again, this has not changed much since last month. The only thing that really changed was the interest piece. So we're sitting again at about $1.2 million, and that's in that annual $1 million CapEx fund that's sitting there. And again, we'll probably sit down with Monica and the Sports Authority, and I would assume the Finance Committee would be a part of that now that the Finance Committee is there, and we'll submit for reimbursement coming up towards the end of this year. And what we have out there in regards to the fund is we have approximately $2.4 million that's currently in our receivable that will come, that we'll ask for some of that money out of the $1.2 million when we do our reimbursement request. And then the casualty is $23,000, and Walter works hand-in-hand with Metro on collecting that casualty loss. So he submits those invoices for reimbursement, and as you can see, it's pretty small. Do I have any questions on finances?
Just another one. So
yes.
Did that receivable go up? Like, was it 1.6 last?
It did. It went up significantly, Margaret. And
wow.
Part of that was the club furniture that has been ordered. As Bob mentioned, we've been doing the storm generator pumps, which was another kind of large project. And he also mentioned the club LED boards that are going in. And so we put a down payment on that as well. So those are all kind of recent receivables and expenses that have been incurred.
Now, the suite furniture was the Titans are going to pay.
That's correct. The suite furniture was actually paid for by the Titans.
All right. So the $800,000 is what?
Some of that is club furniture that has been recently ordered and deposits
okay,
that have been paid on the club furniture. And that includes tables. It includes chairs in the club level. It also includes new tables and new lounge chairs. And then we also ordered the LEDs that are going up into the club area, which are kind of like a rather large indoor TV. I mean, when I say large, it's they're massive. And there's four of those that are going up, two on each side in the club level.
Is there a process by which you check with the Sports Authority before you?
Yes, we sat down with Rich Riebling and Margaret, and Monica was at that meeting, and Toby at the time. And we sat down and walked through kind of our list of items. And then some of the items they selected to be paid out of the bonds or the out of the line of credit that was just issued. And then some of those items they said, we want to roll that through the normal CapEx.
So at the time of last month's meeting, did you know that you were going, when we were told the 1.6, did you know that you were going to go ahead and spend $800,000
yes.
this month?
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. Do I have anything else? Yes, sir.
Walter Holden still with you?
Walter is still here. He's right there.
Oh, okay.
Are you missing Walter?
I didn't see him come in here.
We'll bring Walter up here next month.
Okay. I got to check on Walter.
Walter's still here. He's been working hard. So.
I didn't know he was as soon as he was up or not to put on his football uniform.
I'm waiting for that call.
Okay.
All right. Thank you all so much. If you have any questions or follow-up questions, we're always available. If y'all need any further information, we're happy to provide that.
Great. Thank you, Janine. At our last meeting, we did vote to approve the Nissan Stadium refurbishment project, and on Monday was the closing. Monica is going to update us on where we are with the project overall.
The loan closed on Monday, and we were all very excited about that. And you know, at the September meeting last month, you all received the terms of the loan. You know, there have not been any surprises since that. The banking transaction is being led by Pinnacle Bank, along with First Tennessee and Fifth Third Bank. And each lender has purchased $5 million worth of bonds, which will mature in 12 years. So they basically run concurrent with the life of the stadium lease. And the Sports Authority will keep 1 year of cash reserves, and the interest rate is a 4.5% for the first 5 years. And the Sports Authority will pay for the debt through two revenue streams, the $1 portion of the ticket tax and the Sports Authority's portion of the CMA Music Festival concession sales. So really the report is that the loans have closed, and that's a great thing. Bob Lackey was not able to be here this morning. We are thankful to have Tom Edelman, Metro's treasurer, is here this morning with us, and we appreciate you being here. But that is the good news. As you all know, anytime we close a loan and bonds are issued, there's the CT form that's part of the process that has to be discussed, and so Margaret will do that.
The CT form is essentially a report on the debt obligation. It has to be filed with the state, and all the information that you just heard from Monica is in the form. Some other elements that are in the form are the cost of issuance, which is around $94,000. The fact that we do have a written debt policy, we have to check a box for that. The final maturity is in 12 years. And these are revenue bonds. It's essentially just the notice to the state that we closed the bond transaction on Monday, and it'll need to be signed and filed by the chair. This report also includes a certificate regarding compliance with the terms and conditions of blanket exemption under the Anti-Kicking the Can Act. The Anti-Kicking the Can Act is simply some prohibitions against having balloon debt, meaning we only pay we're not doing this where you only pay interest and then you pay all your principal at the end. So we have to file a certificate regarding that as well. So if you have any questions, let me know, but that is the general presentation. There's no requirement for approval by the board, just simply a presentation.
Any questions?
So now that the loan is closed and we are really ready to get to work, you know, the Sports Authority has been working with our project management group, Larry Adama and the Commonwealth Development Group, and they've been working very diligently with the Titans and the staff to work on a bid package. And so the bids for the seat replacements have been received and are currently being analyzed by the Titans and by our project manager. And an award for the seats is likely to be made in about 10 days is what we're hoping for and what we're expecting. The project management staff and the Titans have reviewed the designs, specifications, and engineering associated with, and this was such an eye-opener when we talked on, when was that, on Monday, that there are 2 miles of expansion joints that need to be repaired. So this is a major project, and the drawings are being finalized right now, and a bid package is being prepared for release to potential contractors. So we have the seats, and then we have the expansion joints, which is the other part of that big project. And so the target release date for the expansion joint is going to be mid-November. An evaluation of the best way to kind of coordinate and schedule the seat replacements and the expansion joint repairs is kind of underway, again, by the Titans and the project management staff, because you've got to remove the seats to get to the expansion joint. So they're working to figure out what's the best way to do that, what makes sense, and what's the most efficient way to do that. And then at the next meeting, then we'll get a full and a complete overview from Larry Adama and Ed Henley and our project management. So they'll be here next week, and we'll have much more detailed information, and we'll be available to answer any other questions.
Great. Thank you, Monica. The Nashville Predators, I believe, had a late night last night, and a successful one. So Sean Henry, president with the Nashville Predators in Bridgestone Arena, will give us the arena and Ford Ice Center update. Good morning.
I didn't bring my PowerPoint, sorry. Well, morning. It was a late night, but it was a good night, wasn't it?
Yeah.
You know, free hockey's good. It's always good to win. It's even better to beat your former team that you worked for, and there were so many of them in our building last night, so I won a few bets, which was fun. But, you know, the report's for August, and I'll talk about September, even though, you know, the finances aren't in there yet. It was the busiest summer we've ever had. You know, July, busiest July we ever had. August, the busiest August we've ever had from an event standpoint. September was the busiest September we ever had, and it's incredible. You were just talking about the seat project at LP or Nissan Stadium. We just went through that this summer as well. So to coordinate the seat project, our expansion joints, redoing all the concrete work in the lower bowl, redoing all the telescopic seating, built around the busiest summer we ever had, is really incredible. David Kell's in the back, and a lot of credit goes to him and Tim Friedenberger for scheduling that in and out. You know, how we ramped up, how we ramped down, and it was absolutely astonishing to see how it all came together. But the end result is, looks like a brand new building, and that's nice. So from all of our renovations this summer, we did about $11 million in renovations, 11.2 to be exact. Of that, I think $5 million came from our SIF program. The other $6.2 million came from either our owners or Delaware North. $3 million from Delaware North, $3.2 from ourselves. And we did everything from redoing all the sports lighting, making us a more environmentally friendly building. But better than that, it makes us a more entertaining building. Because now we can turn the lights on and off. We can play with them, celebrate goals with them. When we do those great intermission shows on our band stage, we can treat it like a concert and change the lighting off it. We can flood the ice with gold, which is always good, and it makes for a better TV broadcast as well. Redid all the gates, all the doors, installed the walk-through metal detectors, refaced all the concession stands, completely gutted and rebuilt 6 of them, renovated half the bathrooms or restrooms, finished the renovation of our suites, or we have 4 more to go, but that plan has started. And just a lot of paint everywhere. Ran out of gold paint in the city of Nashville. And I said that once joking around 2 years ago. We literally ran out of gold paint at Porter Paint this past summer. So we had to put off a few projects, which it's just been a lot of fun. The best part about that is the response from our fans has been incredible. You know, we knew when we were opening we wouldn't be completely ready for our first preseason game. But when you look at the response people had, and they were part of the decisions, part of the improvements, the suggestions came from them. The response has been really, really nice. And we're not done yet, and we won't be done, you know, through the playoffs, even if we're fortunate enough to make them this year, because we're always going to be in a state of renovation. But again, the response has been really, really strong. They're working better than intended. And again, the building looks brand new. And better than that, the results speak for themselves. You know, I talked about it being the busiest summer we've ever had. Through three quarters now, through the calendar year, we're pacing as the second busiest building in America, or North America, rather. Which, you know, you think about that. I think we're the smallest market in the NHL, second smallest in the NHL / NBA, you know, in arena sports. To be the second busiest venue in North America is nothing short of astonishing. But all the credit goes to our fans, our promoters, our acts that have confidence in coming here despite our renovations, despite what other shows are going on. And we're 70,000 tickets behind Madison Square Garden. If I would have said that to you, and I did say it to you 5 or 6 years ago when I first met you, those that were still on the board or on the board then laughed at me when I said someday we'll be the busiest building in the country. And I said, even if we fall short of that, we're going to attain levels that we never thought possible before. And I think being the second busiest building in North America is hitting levels that none of you thought we could do. I don't know if I really thought it either, but we're there. And again, only 70,000 tickets away. And the cutoff was right before our two Taylor Swift shows and Disney on Ice. So we're feeling pretty confident that maybe there's a building in Manhattan with about 13 million people, 2 miles from their doors. They're probably a little nervous about where the rankings are. So things are tremendous. On the ice, it's easy to talk about. You know, we're 5-1. Again, a big win last night, a little late win last night. But it's always nice to win at home, undefeated at home this year. Went on the road, 3 games on the road, came back 2-1, which is always nice to go out on the road early to see what you are. You get the team together. If you hear our coach talk, you'd think we're 0-6, because he'll say we're not playing our best hockey. We've got to keep moving forward. Our best game was probably against the Islanders in their new building in Brooklyn, and we lost that game. I mean, it really probably was our best team game to date. So things are pretty optimistic. I mean, they really are. The right guys are scoring. The right things are happening. The injury bug has pretty much avoided us, though we had a couple guys out of the lineup last night. But we're positioned really well for a good season. I've sold out all 3 games so far. We've got the Anaheim Ducks tomorrow and Pittsburgh on Saturday. I think they'll both be sellouts, which is fun. Much like the Titans, we're excited about all the community events that we get a chance to do. And there's a lot of overlap in what we do with it being domestic violence awareness month. We're very proud of our association with YMCA and the men program that we helped form and put together. We hosted the first coaches symposium, and our goal is to work with middle school coaches to really change the discourse of violence against women. You know, 1 in 4 women will be physically abused, 1 in 6 women will be sexually abused, and our goal with that is to start changing those trends and eventually wipe those numbers, you know, from the face of Nashville. So we're off to a nice start there. And it's great to see other teams jumping on board as well, as we all do things to help change the community. Thursday night is our breast cancer awareness night. We're giving out, and I hate to say that we're not giving out 17,113 gold shirts, but we're giving out 17,113 pink shirts. So we're going to do a pink night to help build that awareness. We're also going to provide free screening for every woman in attendance that would like to do a swab, mail it in to check the DNA on you know, if they have the gene, if you will, to decide how aggressive they should be in future screening. So it's a pretty exciting week, you know, with what happened across the river, and then, of course, what's going to happen in our building this week. So Monday was Community Awareness Day for us, where our entire roster, all of our staff, all of our coaches go out in the community and just touch all the 500-600 organizations that we have an opportunity to work with throughout the year with our foundation. But it's tremendous when you get to see your players spending 2 or 3 hours after practicing at Fort Ice in the middle of the start of the season. It's kind of disrupts every pattern you normally like to be on a team side. But when you look at the mentality of our coach and David Poyle, our GM, and all of our roster. Am I done?
Your time is up.
Normally, I'm used to that buzzing sound. You know? Bob, you can take your finger off the button. But it's fun to see them say, you know what, we need to go practice at Fort Ice, you know, at least once a month. We need to, you know, continue to grow youth hockey. And above and beyond that, then we need to hit the hospital, Cottage Cove, the School for the Blind, and touch it in a little bit more tangible way than just the normal resources when they're writing checks when they show up, and it means so much. So we're off to a great start. The planning for the All-Star game continues to roll out. It's starting to turn from planning to action. activation. I know Scott's going to talk about it in a little bit. The partnership with every corner of this community and what we're doing has been really nice. We're following the model, really, that Margaret, you helped set with the women's Final Four. And what's most encouraging is how, through Fort Ice, we put together a youth tournament to marry up with the All-Star game, where virtually every city in the NHL map will be represented. I think we have 40 teams, or close to 40 teams, that will participate. And it's going to be at Fort Ice. It's going to be at Centennial, and it's going to be down in A-game as well, kind of bringing that hockey community together and letting kids feel like they're all-stars, not just locally, but from around the map as well. Fort Ice Center just continues to shine. We just launched our new, more aggressive scholarship plan. We're going to have a press release on it later this week, but we committed when we opened Fort Ice to do about $50,000 in scholarships in partnership with Metro, and, you know, reach out to those that, you know, can't play hockey from an affordability standpoint. We're pretty excited. Last year, I think we did $200,000 or $250,000 in scholarships, almost five times what we pledged to do. We just launched an initiative that will have us doing closer to $600,000 in scholarships, and we're excited about it. We're working with the Players Union, the NHLPA, the NHL, and our own resources to basically say hockey is free for, I think we just enrolled 80 kids. When I say free, the enrollment, all equipment, you know, the skates, everything that you need to play hockey is free for 80 kids. We just filled that up in one day when we did the signups. We also just launched a program to provide free skates for another 200 kids. So whether you're playing hockey or not, just learning how to skate, or that's all you want to do, it's been a lot of fun. And we talk about Fort Ice Center being a fan factor. We talk about Fort Ice Center helping, you know, to grow hockey throughout the community. What's happening out there is even a little bit more special, because we're actually touching kids that want to try hockey, you know, make it part of what they do, part of basketball, part of football, part of volleyball, part of baseball. And it's nice to be able to do that. The benefits will be tremendous. We continue to grow those scholarships, and we hope to double those almost every year. And if we can do that, you know, great things are happening. And then lastly, just to brag, we're Arena of the Year by Polestar. I hope we get nominated again. Those nominations should come out in a few months. We were also just named Arena of the Year by IEBA, which, David, you got to help me here, is the International Entertainment Buyers Association. There it is. I never get that one right. But it's a real credit, you know, to David and everything on the arena side. It's nice to be recognized. It's better to be recognized locally, and that's what's happening right now, you know, from our fans that are responding to everything that we're doing. So a lot of great things are happening. Again, Scott's going to talk about the All-Star Game. The All-Star Game does not start the last weekend in January. It starts December 12th, and that's when we open Bridgestone Winter Park and the ice rink outside, what I call really the pond, you know, because it's about half the size of a normal rink. We'll do a lot of fun tournaments out there. It's going to be fun to be able to skate under the stars. But again, that opens December 12th, which is also the same day that we're doing our first multi-sport doubleheader. We're doing a Auburn MTSU basketball game in the morning, and then we're doing a Predators game that night. So it's kind of unique for us. We're starting to run out of dates for all the events that we're trying to jam in there. So it's the first time we're doing it. It's funny, I'm nervous about it. Some of the guys made fun of me because I used to be aggressive, they said, and now I'm getting soft because I want us to practice the conversion two or three times to get it down, and we will, and it'll be perfect. The best part about it is the confidence our coach has in what we do every day, because normally the first phone call you get is from the coach saying, whoa, what are you doing? We can't do our morning skate there. What's the ice going to look like that night? How bad is it going to be? That call didn't come when we talked to him about it. He said, that's great. Let's just keep filling it up. So it really shows how that partnership that we've always talked about is coming together and blossoming. So, I mean, things are just really good. Again, you have the finances in front of you. It's easy to talk about being up 200%, 250% in revenue, I think 1,000% in the bottom line, or some crazy numbers. I can't do the math, but Kyle fortunately did, and it's in this letter. If you have any questions about that or what we're doing in the community, love to answer it. But we just have a lot of positive things going right now.
So, you do have a lot of positive things going on. Great report.
Don't finish that with a but. It's an early morning.
I just have a question about the income statement, and it's a fabulous statement, but there's the but. You know, I noticed.
I got to take it out now.
There's the bottom line is so good versus what we've seen in the past, and I just, you know, the summary that you did mentions that, and it is really worth knowing, especially for newer members of the authority, to look at these numbers and the difference between the 2014 actual and the 2015 actual is, you know, the bottom. That's really $1 million. That's a big difference. What I have a question about, though, is that I noticed that the budget for August 2015 actually had a positive, which is at the bottom line, which is something we don't really ever see. And so I'm just wondering, you know, can you kind of take me through what happened in August versus what the budget was? Were we going to turn a corner right then and we almost turned the corner? Or kind of what happened in the month?
I think when we looked at our opportunity for all the events we were doing in August, despite the renovations, that we said, you know, let's still do the events. Because the one thing we always say is we need to continue to do events, bring people into the downtown corridor, regardless of what expenses are sometimes. And it would have been a lot easier when you talked about scheduling the seat replacements to just block events and say, you know what, we're going to shut down the month, you know, from July 15th through September 8th. And we're going to come in and we're going to just take all the old seats out, do the expansion joints, you know, grind all the concrete down, recoat it, install the seats. And it would have been easy. It would have been great. We probably would have lost, I don't know, $100,000, $200,000 in August if we did that. And we said, no, we're better off ramping up, ramping down, ramping up, ramping down. The cost of ramping up and ramping down is our cleaning bills, just as one example, were about five times what they normally would be for an event, because at 2 o'clock every event day, we shut construction down. We brought in a crew. Normally a pregame crew is about 10 people, just do the final dusting, if you will. We brought in a crew of about 60 people that literally started one end of the concrete. Of course, every seat, blew it all out, scrubbed it, mopped it, you know, did those things, replenished it. And then, as soon as they were done, another crew would come in, you know, after the event, clean the event, but then put Visqueen up and all the construction barriers back up, start construction again. We do another event, or break it on down. One of the best things I saw, two of the nicer guys in our organization, David Kells and Tim Friedenberger, who's not here yet, almost come to blows over, no, we can't add another event. You can't do it, David. You can't do it, David. You can't do it, David. And you look at the events that we did in August, he did it, he did it, he did it. But that really ramped up, you know, the operational expenses to do that. We had to rent a lot of equipment to get through the food and beverage shutdown, you know, because we had, you know, six of our main stands completely gutted and closed, where we had to go out and rent, you know, about $20,000 worth of equipment.
That really helps, just to kind of understand, yeah. Because, I mean, breaking even is amazing, actually, yeah. In what you described.
Yeah, and there were a lot of discussions about it. And, you know, what we always say is
the difference in the budget, kind of how that yeah. happens.
So. We always say is you need to continue to do events, and you need to blow those events out, and you need to do them well so people continue to come back. And whether that's an event in our building, at the Ryman, at Nissan Stadium, it doesn't matter. We want events to sell out. We want people to leaving thinking what a great experience it was. And that's why it was important to take on those extra expenses if we were doing them.
Okay.
Well, thank you. Appreciate the pink tie.
Thank you, Sean.
Wear it tomorrow, too, though, okay? Thanks, guys.
Scott Ramsey, President and CEO of the Nashville Sports Council, is here with us this morning.
Great.
The mission of the Sports Council is to positively
right.
impact the economy and quality of life of the greater Nashville area by attracting and promoting professional and amateur sports. This is a membership organization, and so if anyone is not a member of the Sports Council,
we'd love to
they
have them.
Should be. It's a great networking opportunity. I know our own Vice Chair, Margaret Bem, is on your board and is very active in promoting the work that you guys
I agree with what you just said.
Do. And again, if you're not a member, please join, and Scott will give us an update. Thank you.
Well, first of all, thanks for having me, and I appreciate Monica inviting us every now and then to kind of come and give you a little update. You know, I think one of the things, and I'll talk about it in a few slides here, but I think one of the things that Toby and Monica and kind of throughout time, we've been confused between the Sports Authority and the Sports Council, and we've always taken that as a positive, in that if people think of us as one, that means we're working together pretty well and getting things done, and that's never really been a negative in our eyes and something that we've always kind of just kind of laughed and rolled off. You know, Toby always said, well, I'm the good-looking one, and I was kind of argued with him on that. But but anyway, I appreciate being here and giving you a little bit of an update on the next few months. Not going to go into a whole lot of detail, but the next few months are pretty exciting for us from the Sports Council perspective, and I think from the authority's viewpoint as well. Just backing up a little bit, Kim kind of touched on this, but I think just kind of, again, give you a background maybe for some of you that aren't as familiar with us. We really have two nonprofit organizations, and I say we. It's really we as a community. The Music City Bowl is a 501c3 organization. It has a board of about 30 folks. The National Sports Council is a 501c6 organization. It has a board of about 75 or so, but a real active executive committee of about 17 or 18. Those two boards have an agreement that we share staff. That's really allowed us to be very efficient, both from an administrative standpoint, but really effective from the standpoint of relationship building. We've been able to be very unified and very consistent over the years with our external relationships as we're recruiting and bidding on events, but at the same time internally, as we work with you all, the facilities, the partners, the private sector, and be very consistent in what we've done, and we think that model has served us very well. And quite frankly, there's four or five cities now that are trying to go to that model, where they've had separate organizations that somewhat kind of have some competing missions. But you know, our mission has really kind of not changed. Go out and recruit events that bring both economic impact, great visibility, and engagement of not only the local community, but bringing tourists in that complement the NFL schedule, the NHL schedule, the Sound schedule, and obviously events like the marathon that hopefully showcase the city in a very positive way. Over the years, we've really, while we've looked at the mission, as Margaret knows, over the board several times, we've really not changed it much because we feel like that's the role that we serve, and it's a complementary role to you all and the facilities that we have. We have a big 6 months really coming up, and I'll just touch on a couple of the real anchor kind of activities that we're working on day to day. The bowl game, it's hard to believe it's our 18th game, but it is, and it's more importantly, it's the second year of our new six-year agreement. The first 16 years, we ran in four-year contract cycles, and those contracts were between the bowl organization and the participating conferences that participate in the game. We've had SEC, we've had ACC, we've had Big Ten. We are currently in a six-year agreement, year two, with the SEC, and the opposition will either be the ACC or the Big Ten for the 6 years, which gives us a lot of flexibility in teams, hopefully a better opportunity and higher probability to bring more fans, higher visibility, and I think last year's LSU-Notre Dame game really kind of emphasized that ability to kind of move up and us being able to fund that increase in selection process. Again, excitingly, we've got a 12-year agreement with ESPN this year. We're on prime time December 30th. Again, thanks to the Titans and Nissan Stadium for kind of helping us always with maximizing the time that really fits best with the city. Obviously, now we dovetail into New Year's Eve activities and a lot of things that we didn't have several years ago. ESPN's been a great partner, and our title sponsor, Franklin American Mortgage, local company. They're in the second year of a six-year agreement with us as well, which really gives us some financial stability as we move forward. You know, it's always fun to kind of look back occasionally, and the bowl, you know, I remember in the late 90s, we're kind of thinking about starting it, and there were a lot of things going on, but to think about, you know, where we've come in 18 years and creating, you know, over $250 million in direct spending and 75 million people watching the city and bringing in almost a million folks has been, I think, a great success story for, again, trying to put an event in the stadium that's impactful and a positive nature in a time of year that we didn't have a whole lot of folks coming or let alone a national broadcast. So we're excited about the future. We think we continue to improve, and a lot of it goes to some great partnerships. Moving on, and Sean alluded to this, the All-Star Game, certainly it's been a topic in the last several months. We've been working feverishly, really, on getting this together. I will say in the 20 years I've been fortunate enough to be here and be a part of the Sports Council, this has probably been the most demanding event that we've ever were done from the standpoint of timing. Typically, an event of this magnitude, when you're thinking of national, international stage, a lot of folks coming in, and you want to create a platform for your city that maybe is the only time you get a chance to do it that really sets a standard, you usually want more than 12 months to plan that and coordinate that with everyone necessary. And that's all the time that we've had, really 13 months. And that's a really short planning period. As Margaret knows, we worked hard on the Women's Final Four for really 4 or 5 years to really kind of vet and plan and organize and fundraise. So it's really been on a fast track, but I think it's an event that the city's really going to be proud of. We've really worked hard. We've got great engagement of all sectors of the community on our board. We have now kind of created a model that seems to be kind of rolling along, very similar to what we had in the very first sporting event that we ever had, the U.S. Figure Skating Championships in 97. We created a C3 that just ran that event, and then we served as the management group for that and kind of coordinated all the necessary elements. We had a great success with that model for the Women's Final Four. We have created a C3, which has helped us with fundraising for the All-Star Game as well, and has all the necessary partners involved in that. But certainly been a great formula for us. We think it engages the community across all sectors and at the same time gives us a chance to maximize the ability to put on a great event. You know, kind of think back, to reflect again, if you fast forward to early February and you look back on thinking that 20 years ago, you think of the last week of December and the last week of January being key figurehead kind of moments for us from the sports standpoint. I'm not sure we could have gotten there, but think of the bowl, the New Year's Eve event, the hockey games, the Titans games, all the things going on between Christmas and New Year's, and then the last week of January to have an international set of media roll in here and an expectation that this could be the greatest All-Star game that the NHL has had is kind of a fun road to go down occasionally. So we're excited about it, but it is still something that we are working on every day, to be honest with you. Sean mentioned, I think one of the goals of the All-Star game, it was an exciting announcement a couple weeks ago, thanks to Bridgestone, Gary Garfield, and Chris Karbowiak for their support. Bridgestone stepped up and is helping us sponsor what we're going to call Winter Park, and we're really going to kind of try to take the event and extend it beyond the two or three games that are in Bridgestone Arena and create a real community event in Walk of Fame Park in that corridor and really kind of create some activities that are free, that are accessible, that are inexpensive, all of the above to various sectors in the community. Sean alluded to we're going to have an ice rink down there. It's going to open December 12th, so we'll have 6 weeks to kind of lead in. It'll overlap the bowl, overlap New Year's Eve events, it'll overlap concerts, hockey games, Titans games, and kind of lead right into All-Star Week. At that time, we will kind of roll out a stage. We'll have free open concerts. We'll have interactives from sponsors and hospitality tents, and we really think it's going to showcase Nashville in a way that you don't want to be the city to follow us to host the All-Star Game is our goal. So we're excited about that, and we're still kind of planning that. We'll have more announcements as we come along. Moving along, again, I kind of said the next 6 months are kind of big. If you think about the bowl game in December and the All-Star game in January, we roll right into the SEC men's basketball tournament in March, and then our Rock and Roll Nashville marathon, half marathon in April. So that's a pretty huge successive set of massive events about every month. Each one of them have kind of different touch points. This is the second year of a 12-year agreement with the SEC. It's the first time that they've ever selected an anchor city for their basketball tournaments. We'll have 9 men and 3 women's tournaments now with the birth of the SEC Network and partnership with ESPN. All games are nationally televised from here, and it's been a sellout every year, and it's a very exciting kind of plan now to kind of keep building on making that event better, and we're a great destination for the SEC fans, and again, it's due to great partnerships and allowing us to kind of bid that far out. out and commit a week in the arena every year to allow us to kind of bid on that. The marathon continues to do really well. As most of you know, St. Jude's a major charity partner. I think they created almost $2 million in one day last year. It's our ninth year in a row that we've been over 32,000 registrants. We start downtown now, end at Nissan Stadium, and it's continues to be a very popular destination. We engage almost 2,500 volunteers in the community to put that event on, to organize and stage them a band every mile. So it's a great positive event for our city. Recently also, we landed the 2018 men's first and second round. So the next two or three years are really going to be a very exciting schedule of events for us. One of the things, as Margaret knows, about 15 years ago, I think the biggest question was, are your events successful? How do you define success? And so we started, and we've been very consistent for 15 years, really doing surveys. So we don't really interpret the data. We just kind of report the data based on the surveys that we get back from attendees, both locally and out of town. And it's always pretty exciting to look at the numbers as they start getting pretty large. But since 92, some of that's an estimate, but we're nearing almost $700 million in impact, over 3 million in spectators, and 340 hours of national television coverage. But more importantly, I think if you look at it from 30,000 feet, I think it goes to the point that when we bid on events, we're usually looking 3 to 6 years out. So typically, during that event cycle, you can't bid on it for another 3 or 4 years. We've now had Bridgestone Arena, Nissan Stadium, and now the addition of this ballpark, the opportunity to bid on those 2 and 3 times. Them coming back, I say they, being the events, whether it be the bowl, basketball tournaments, the Women's Final Four, you know, gymnastics, whatever, has been, they've had a great experience here. To get those events back means that, and to bid them long term has really, I think, gone to our model that we have delivered or exceeded their expectations in all aspects. And obviously, it's driven great results from us, from our mission, from not only bringing in tourism and impact and dollars to the community, but also a great promotional vehicle and engagement vehicle for the local community. Lastly, I think it's kind of listening to everybody today and opportunity to kind of just kind of talk a little bit about the Sports Council. We're pretty fortunate, I think, in that we're a city that is envied by many in our industry because of the great collaboration that we've been able to achieve. And certainly that starts with Metro. We recruit the majority of our events to Metro facilities. We work with you all. We work with the Titans. We work with the Preds. We work with the Sounds on bidding those. We also, the colleges are great supporters. Certainly the Metro departments, anytime you close roads and want to do events like the Bridgestone Winter Park, and the coordination there from police and public works and Metro Council is critical. And then the private sector, obviously they've stepped up and funded a vast majority of the events for the good of the city from a civic perspective. And then you tie in the hospitality and the hotel industry, the entertainment community, as you'll see, is really involved in the All-Star Game. And lastly, you know, about 3,000 people step up to volunteer to put this on every year. And while that's a number you can kind of throw out there, if you think about scheduling everybody a volunteer level for a four-hour shift, 3,000 of those folks, it's pretty impressive. So I think when you put all that into one bag, we're pretty fortunate that we've been able to kind of start from the beginning in the late 90s of working together, and I think it's delivered great results for hopefully the facilities that you all oversee and for the community at large. So that's all I got. Any questions, thoughts?
Thank you, Scott.
Great. Thanks for having me.
We appreciate the work of you and your team, and we like being an active partner and the good things you're doing for our community. And
appreciate it.
Thank you, Margaret, and to the rest of your board.
Thank you.
Coach.
Thanks.
Coach, thank you. Our our next meeting is scheduled for November 18th, and I think Monica noted we also have a finance committee that will be meeting on November 4th to review the Bridgestone Arena audit and Stewart parking.
Call meeting.
And so there will be notice of that meeting.
Just in public notice about a week in advance.
For both of those. Is there any other business of this body? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Thank you. We're adjourned.